So far, we have studied mostly statics, both electrostatics and magnetostatics, where the only part that was time dependent was when we drive the green functions. So we will use those green functions in the second part. So this part will be mostly dynamics, but since electrostatics and magnetostatics are special cases of dynamics, I may at some places drive statics result as a special case of electrodynamics. So in this half of the course, we will try to cover a few important topics. And the first one would be plane waves, where we will study how the plane waves are generated and their interactions with the planar boundaries of material mediums and their properties. Plane waves are important because all other waves can be written as a spectrum of plane waves. So the study of plane waves is not only basic, but it's also used in constructing other types of waves and solution to those problems. So we'll spend about 2 weeks on this, and then we will go on to study the production of electromagnetic waves by charged particles, moving charged particles. Like what happens to the electromagnetic field when, say, a charged particle enters from vacuum to a material medium, like the particles coming from outer space to the atmosphere, or when particles go from one medium to another medium, or of the waves produced by particles traveling in a dielectric medium. So we'll spend quite a bit of time and the electromagnetic waves generated by moving particles. And then the third part would be what happens to charged particles in an external electromagnetic field. So in this part, we will concentrate and the fields radiated by the particles, and will neglect anything that happens to the particles because of the other electromagnetic fields. And in this part, we will study the reverse effect, that if there are particles in an external electromagnetic field, what happens to them? What are their motions? And in this part, then we will neglect the fields produced by the charges themselves. And if we have time, we will try to understand the conservation laws, like the conservation of energy and conservation of momentum, and then their applications. So today we will begin from plane waves. First we will see their production, and then we will see how we can solve problems of reflection, transmission of electromagnetic waves from boundaries. For many of you, it may be a repetition, so we'll try to go through these topics quickly. So it will almost be like a revisit. So we know that using potentials, we can express the electromagnetic fields like this. Where these potentials satisfy the wave equations, let's say for A, phi. Under Lorentz gate, because if you use some other gate, this equation would be different. The gate was this. The solution of these equations was also found using the green functions, because to write the solution of these equations, let's say in Cartesian coordinates, all these equations are isomorphic, that they are like this, because we can write this in component form, at least in Cartesian coordinates, and then using the green function we can write solution for both. So solve these equations, we had used the solution of this equation. So this was the green function for this equation that we found using Fourier transform. So if we have this green function, we can write the solution for any input using the integral, which is that if, let's say, instead of this equation, we have an equation of this type. So all we need is to evaluate, let's now call it some y. So y now is 3 integrals over space, 1 integral over time. Can evaluate this integral and write solution of this. So using this thing, the solution of the vector potential equation would be, so F is mu naught J, so mu naught gets out, and then there is 4 pi for this green function, this gets out, and we have delta of t minus t prime over this into j of this thing. The integral over t prime can be evaluated. We can replace t prime by t minus r minus r prime over c, because we have to replace with something where this is, this function is 0. Argument is 0, because that's the only point where this function is non-zero. At every other point this is 0. So this time integral goes away. We have j of r prime t minus from C. Similarly, we can write solution for the scalar potential. rho of r prime . Everybody is okay with this thing? So this is the repetition from this. Okay. So let's now find E and B for a very simple current distribution. And the situation is like this. Let's consider an infinite current sheet, let's say this is z axis, x, y, and let's take the sheet to be like this, that the sheet is in the xy plane and there is a current on this sheet, and this sheet is infinite in x and y direction. Okay, so there's a current, let's say, going along. So let's take the right handed part of the system, x, y, and this. Let's label this as y and this as x. So the current is moving along x and the whole xy plane is such that the current is moving throughout. Along z axis, it has almost zero thickness. So its charge density can be written as the volume charge density. So it's going along x. Let's say the magnitude is some j naught. And let me take a cosine function in time, and in z it is a delta function. Okay. So it's independent of x and y, so it means it's present at every x, y, and along z axis it's a delta function, it's only present say at the origin. And let's take rho to be 0, because we can imagine that, let's say this sheet is made up of some conductor and the conductor is neutral, so only, let's say, the electrons are moving in this direction downward so that the current goes up, but the even due to the current flow, the conductor remains neutral, and that's usually the case with currents, right? When current moves in a conductor, the conductor is still neutral because the number of electrons and protons in any small volume is still equal. It's only that the electrons are moving along. So there is a current, but there is no charge density. When we will go towards problem number 2, when we will study moving charges, in that case we will have both the charge densities and currents. Because when a charge moves, since it's a charge, so there is a charge density, and since it moves, there's a current. So we'll go to more complicated situations in the second part. So here, let's take this simple geometry, so that phi is 0. Since rho is 0, so phi is 0. And A would be, to compute A, I need this thing. And this will be, let me first write this thing. So what we do, we have a function of r and t. We change r to r prime and t to, we have to change t to t minus this thing. So essentially, we are going to find the retarded current density. So this is x directed. J naught cosine, and in place of t we have t minus this thing, and delta z becomes delta z phi. So this is the current distribution that we will substitute here. So now A is and the integration is over dx prime, dy prime, dz prime. And this r minus r prime thing is this. This is x minus x prime squared, y minus y prime squared, z minus z prime squared. So we can evaluate integral over z prime very easily because it's a delta function. So we get, since this is a constant fluid vector, this can be taken out, this j naught can come out. So we have x hat mu naught j naught 4 pi. So only the integral over x prime and y prime is left. And we have cosine omega t minus omega over c. So we replace c prime with 0. So because this is delta of z prime, so at z prime is equal to 0, this is non-zero. So this becomes x minus x prime squared, y minus y prime squared. This is 0, so this becomes z squared. Similarly here, it's like this, where the integral is over actually this infinite sheet now. So you can solve this integral as it is. It's actually not a difficult integral. And you can get, let's say, the potential here, up here, up here, up here. But since this is an infinite sheet, so because of the infinite sheet, the potential here and potential here will be the same if the distance from this sheet for both of these points is the same. Because it shouldn't matter if you are computing field here or here, right? This has a translational symmetry in xy plane. So for easiness, we can also compute, let's say, the field at z axis only, and that would be the field everywhere. So let's compute at x axis. At x axis, x and y are 0. So these x, y, z are field coordinates, x prime, y prime are source coordinates. So let's put this x 0, y 0. So this becomes a little bit easier to handle. But the integral can still be computed in the same, like this as well. It doesn't actually matter. So this becomes x prime squared, y prime squared, z prime squared. Z prime, no, so this is z and these two are prime. So Everybody's okay so far? So let's do a trick to simplify the problem, the integral. This cosine function can be written as the real part of exponential of this, exponential iota of this. So let's use that thing. So this a then is x hat mu naught j naught 4 pi real of. So this is exponential iota all of this, and this exponential iota omega t can get out of the integral. So let me write this in here, and we have exponential iota minus actually omega over c x prime square y prime square z square dx prime dy. These limits are set. So there is this real thing that we have to carry on now. After we evaluate the integral, we will take the real part and we have an answer. Now this integral, I will send you these notes. I have solved it in detail. You have to move into polar coordinates and simplify it, and it actually becomes like this. And what you can do, come to the tutorial session on Friday at 11:30, and Kamran will solve this integral for you, and the answer comes the integral is actually transformed into an integral of this type u du. Because when you transfer it to the polar coordinate, this integral over plane is converted into the integral over, let's say, rings, and then the radius and the angle, you have to integrate over the radius and the angle of the ring, and can convert it into this type. So this becomes integral like this. Which can be solved easily because this is just an exponential integral. So in this 4 pi is not. So this actually becomes 2. Because you have an integral over radius, which is written here, and then you have an integral over theta, which comes out to be 2 pi, so 2 pi cancels with this thing. So we have mu naught j naught over 2 real part of this thing, and that integral is exponential minus iota omega over c u minus iota omega over c, and these are the limits. So we first substitute this this upper limit, which is exponential. So let's take this iota above. This is iota c over omega exponential minus iota omega over c infinity minus iota c over omega minus iota omega over c z naught. Now this infinity thing has come up here, which is a little bit problematic, but for uniquely specifying this potential, because this then depends on how large the sheet we take. But for fields, it will not have any problem, because whatever this is, it's just a constant. Let's take this C over omega outside. So this is just a constant. And this constant is between plus minus 1. So we have a complex number over which has plus minus 1 value depending on the exact value of this number. But so this is A here. And let's first compute, let's say, the electric field. So electric field is minus partial A by partial T, which is, and we can actually take the real part if we want. Let's continue this thing for a while. So this is the real part of this thing. So let's first take the real part of this. So this is iota omega t going here, and there's this minus iota. So this will be cosine t minus omega over c. That's right. So this is c1 like this minus iota. Let's take this. This is iota omega t. Let's take iota common, so this is omega over c like this. Two omega real of, so this is something, let me write it, some c2. And in general, this will have a t part. And the real part of this thing is, this is a cosine of this plus iota sine of this. Plus iota will be multiplied with this plus. So this is plus sine omega t minus omega over c. So this is A. So B is del cross A. And A has only one component, Ax. So this thing would be, this x component is 0. This y component would be, no, this is not 0. This would be minus into minus plus. So this is y hat partial Ax by partial z. And z component would be 0 because this is not y dependent. There is no y dependency. So this is this. Okay, so let's take its derivative with respect to z. So, sorry? Will this be 0? यहाँ पे आपका जीरो आएगा। हाँ, डेरिवेटिव लोड लेंगे इसका तो डेरिवेटिव जीरो आ जाएगा। So this constant is here, mu naught c j naught 2 omega, इसका डेरिवेटिव जीरो आ गया। इसका डेरिवेटिव रिस्पेक्ट टू z क्या होगा? Let's first assume that z is positive. So in that case, the derivative of sine is minus or plus cosine? Plus होता है. उसके बाद फिर इसका derivative respect to z, which is minus omega over c. So minus omega over c से cancel हो जाएगा. We put minus here. Now this is the result for z greater than 0. For z less than 0, this will be negative, so this is plus. So there will be omega over c, so this will be plus sign. So for z less than 0, it's this. Okay? So on this side of the sheet, the magnetic field is directed along negative y-axis, and on the other side of the sheet the magnetic field is directed along positive y-axis. We have sign pe gadbad kiya, mere paas sign ulte hain yahan pe. ये हमने साइन सही ली. सो ये माइनस से योटा हमने ऊपर लाके प्लस से योटा कर दिया. प्लस से योटा सी ओवर ओमेगा. और पहले हमने इनफिनिटी पुट की, ये आ गया. फिर माइनस ये आ गया. सो हाँ ठीक है, मैं क्या नोट्स में लिखी है. सो मैंने स्कैन तो कर ली होगा, आप उसमें वो माइनस पे कोई इफेक्ट कर लीजिए. सो दिस इज द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड, व्हिच मींस दैट ऑन दिस साइड ऑफ द शीट द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इज इनटू द बोर्ड, एंड ऑन दिस साइड ऑफ द शीट द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इज आउट ऑफ द बोर्ड. लेट्स नाउ सी द इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड. The electric field can be obtained in a couple of ways. We can, let's say, get directly the field from that formula, but this t dependent part has cropped up, which is not finite, which is not defined. So instead of using this, let's use Maxwell equations to find E. So we know that del cross B is mu naught epsilon naught partial E by partial T. So we can use this equation to find the electric. So let's take the del cross of this thing. So del cross B is we have only BY. So this is this component is x component is this is 0, this is minus partial dy by partial z. Y component is 0, z component is also 0 because this is not function of x. So this is what we have. So minus x hat. Now we have to do it for both z greater than and smaller than 0. So let's first take z greater than 0. Put this mod here as well. So we are finding the field here and here where there is no J. J is only in the sheet. So we are going to find the field in the source field region here and the source field. So for z greater than 0, we have mu naught, J naught over 2, and the derivative of cosine is minus sine. So there's a minus over there for z greater than 0. So that minus and derivative minus goes away. So we have sine omega t minus omega over c z, and then the derivative to z of this thing is minus omega over c. So this comes here, this becomes plus omega over c. This is for z greater than 0. For z smaller than 0, we have minus x. So this thing is here. Cosine ka derivative here, ab dekhen wahan pe niche plus hai, theek hai? To cosine ka derivative lenge to minus sign aayega, to wo minus jo hai wo is minus ko aake plus kar dega. And we have the derivative of cosine as sine omega t plus omega over z, and iska jo derivative hai omega over c bahar aa jayega. So this is plus hai, so this will be plus. So isko combine karke hum yun bhi likh sakte hain, mu naught j naught omega over 2 c sin omega t minus omega over c z mod. So now this is true for greater than smaller than z. So this is del cross b.
Suppose z greater than 0 is minus
z. Z? Ye bala? Ek minus ye hai. एक माइनस वहां पे ऊपर लगाओ, ठीक है? एक माइनस डेरिवेटिव से आएगा जब कोसाइन का माइनस है, और एक माइनस माइनस ओमेगा सी से आएगा. तो चार माइनस तो ये प्लस हो गया, ये भी प्लस हो गया. ये हमारे पास आ गया डेल क्रॉस बी. सो दिस इज इक्वल टू सो पार्शियल ई भी पार्शियल ई इज ये जो म्यू नॉट एप्सिलॉन नॉट दिस इज 1 ओवर सी स्क्वायर. सो दिस कम्स हियर बिकम सी स्क्वायर. So this is c square del cross b. So isko c square se multiply karte hain, we will have x hat mu naught j naught omega c over 2 sine omega t minus omega over c z mod. So let's say keep it integrated on both sides respect to t. So we have e as iska integral aa jayega cosine plus sine ka pata hai minus ka sine. और ओवर ओमेगा भी आएगा, तो ये ओमेगा कैंसिल. So, because integral respect to T here, this thing doesn't matter. So, this is our electric field. Minus pi. Sine theta to cos theta. So let's come here. So the electric field. We can try to do that in detail, but we can do it by indefinite integral.
Indefinite integral
plus constant,
exactly the same as that constant.
Well, if you constant, infinite polar part. किस तरह सब करें इसको इंटीग्रेट करें फ्रॉम लेट्स से 0 टू t सो दिस इज 0 एंड देन वी हैव टू पुट t सो फॉर 0 वी हैव दिस थिंग व्हिच इज ओमेगा ओवर c z मॉड राइट सो ये जो है इसको अगर हम d बाय dt करते हैं सो वी हैव समथिंग लाइक दिस एंड देन अब क्योंकि ये जो चीज है c1 दिस इज कोसाइन ऑफ दिस पार्ट कोसाइन ऑफ दिस पार्ट ठीक है सो दिस देयर सम बट इट्स अ कांस्टेंट सो इट्स जब इसका हम लेंगे रियल पार्ट सो वी विल हैव समथिंग लाइक दिस कोसाइन ओमेगा t minus omega over c let's say infinity something like this omega over c infinity sath aata hai to wo constant ki tab ye undefined constant hai theek hai lekin wo defined constant hoga okay so let's see we have not made any signs problem minus आना नहीं चाहिए लेकिन यहाँ तो हमने यहाँ पे नहीं minus किस
किया
ये minus वो आएगा क्योंकि इसका होगा this minus this so this minus actually doesn't matter for now so the electric field is directed along x axis on this side the magnetic field is directed along minus y axis so this is the direction of magnetic field this is the direction of electric field and if you curl your fingers from e to b okay so there should be a minus actually that's fine so if you curl your fingers from e to b your thumb points in the direction of propagation so this is a wave that propagates along z axis so on this side we have electric field still pointing downward and magnetic field is now along positive y axis and if you curl your fingers from e to b your thumb still points in the direction of propagation so magnetic field here is into the board here it is out of the board and what we can do is let's rewrite them in a compact manner. Let's say we write E as E naught cosine omega t minus omega c z mod and B as B was with B. Okay, so minus plus y at some d naught cosine omega t minus omega c z mod, where e naught is mu naught j naught c over 2, and b naught is mu naught j naught over 2. And what's the ratio between the two? It's so you see, E naught gets out to be equal to C B naught. But this ratio is true only in vacuum. Okay, remember this. We can see another property from this thing, and that is the discontinuity of the magnetic field. If you see the sheet, so this is the sheet, this is the z-axis, this is xyx plane, so the sheet is here. Now I'm drawing the classic. The electric field on this side was this. The electric field on this side was this, but the magnetic field on this side was this, and on this side it was directed out. So electric field is continuous across this front sheet, but the magnetic field is discontinuous. Let's find the amount of discontinuity between the fields. So what we do, we find the value of B on this side, right next to the sheet at this point, and we find the value of B on this side, right next to the sheet at this point, and then take the difference to see the magnitude of discontinuity. So let me write it B plus, which is on this side, minus B minus, which is on that side. So what is B plus? B plus is minus y hat b, let's write b naught for the moment, and then we put z is equal to 0, so we get cosine omega t minus, what's the b on the other side? It is y hat b naught cosine omega t. So this becomes minus y hat into 2, and the value of b naught is mu naught j naught over 2 cosine omega t. So this is minus y hat mu naught j naught cosine omega t, and this thing is what? This is the magnitude of the current density. Not the volume current density, but the magnitude of the surface current density. This is actually the surface current that is flowing on it. So this J, we can write it like this. K delta Z. This whole is volume current density, but this alone is surface current density, where K is x hat j naught cosine omega t. So using this definition of K, I can write this thing as let's try to write it in a certain way. So mu naught is here. So if I write it as z cross K, a K cross Z, but let's try to Z cross K. So this Z is the, so not Z. So here I have found B plus on this side, and the minus that I am doing is the field on this side. So let's define a surface normal in this direction. So just for the convention, I can write it like that, but let's write it like this, that I'm drawing the normal from this side to this side. So in this case, this normal is minus z, let's call it n hat. So we can write it as n hat cross k. Will this give this thing? Minus z cross that thing, z cross x is y, So that minus will give this minus. So we get this thing. So when this n is from this to this side, I can also write it like this, b minus minus b plus mu naught z cross t. Because if we subtract this one from this, we will get positive. So I can write it z cross t. In this case, this z is from this to this side, right? The z that is from minus to plus. So this thing actually forms this special result that we have obtained for this thing is true for general surface currents as well. So it's actually written conventionally. Instead for magnetic field, it's written for magnetic induction, it's written for H fields, which I can do by dividing with B naught. So this gives me H plus minus H minus equal N cross. So this is one more definition that has to be satisfied at any current surface. Cos omega t जो हम k के अंदर है, क्योंकि k जो है, it's x at k not cos omega t. असल में बात तो सिर्फ यहाँ तक ही है कि हमने ये देख लिया है कि magnetic field इतनी amount से discontinuous है, ठीक है? लेकिन ये थोड़ा सा मैंने ये किया है, क्योंकि this leads to a result which is actually valid for every surface current density. हाँ जी, n k sin theta, और उसकी direction क्या होगी? From n to k, ठीक है? अब लेकिन उसके बजाय अगर आप n को वो use करें minus z hat, ये k को ये लिख लें, तो आप आसानी से z cross x जो है वो y find कर सकते हैं। बजाय sin theta जाने का, z cross x y होता है minus plus या minus one. तो इम्पॉर्टेंट जो चीज ये है कि अगर आप इस रिलेशन को यूज करना चाहें इसको डायरेक्टली, तो जो नॉर्मल वेक्टर है या जो क्रॉस वाला वेक्टर है, इट्स फ्रॉम दिस साइड टू दिस साइड, क्योंकि उल्टा करेंगे तो वो माइनस का आ जाएगा, फिर उधर से उधर को जाएगा. ओके, सो दिस टेल्स अस हाउ वी कैन थिंक ऑफ प्रोडक्शन ऑफ प्लेन इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक वेव्स. बट एज यू सी दैट there can't be any current distribution like the one we have studied so far, right? It's going to infinity, so it's unrealistic. So electromagnetic plane waves in their true form can never exist. They're idealizations. They're just like free particles or point particle concepts in science and engineering. These idealizations help us analyze things, because in a lot of situations, first of all, practical things can be modeled using these things. For example, the light that is coming from sun, it's when you are close to sun, it's almost like spherical waves going like this. But when you are far away and your area of interest is very small, it's almost like a plane. So in that situation, we can use these expressions for electromagnetic wave, electromagnetic fields to model those waves. But actually, their utility is not, if their utility was only this, that they can be used to model several practical situations approximately, then they won't be that common. Their actual utility is that you can write general actual electromagnetic waves or any function as a spectrum of these things. Right, we know that we can write a Fourier transform. Fourier transform is what? It's a superposition of, let's say, cosine-sinusoidal function in its simplest form. So these are cosinusoidal functions, so it means we can write any wave as a combination of plane waves. Okay. Any questions or comments so far? And actually we had a difficulty during computation, like an infinity constant coming in, an undefined constant, simply because the situation is unrealistic. If you take a realistic run distribution, everything will come out to be alright. Okay, so let's now move on to the notations for representing these plane waves. So these are actual expressions that we can use to represent plane waves propagating along z-axis. When the wave is propagating along positive z-axis, let's say, you can write the electric field with this thing, just remove these bars and this minus sign will remain here. And the magnetic field, we can write it like this. So this will positive and you take this negative sign. If the wave is traveling along negative z-axis, this will remain the same, this will become plus z, this will become plus z, and this will then become plus sign. So now I'm going to actually give you a summary of writing plane waves, that actually everyone should remember, even though it's a bit of an off message, but these are little basic things, notational things that you should remember, should actually repeat them several times and memorize them. Because based on this we can make some rules, so that we don't always have to go to this crunch sheet to drive the results when, say, you're solving a problem. You can just write them directly. If there's a plane wave, let's say, propagating along z-axis, and you are asked to write its electromagnetic field, you can write directly electric field like this. So let's say this is x-axis, this is y-axis. Choose any direction for electric field that is perpendicular to z. So let me take, let's say, x-axis for the moment. And it's going along positive z. This expression is always going to be like this. And then you can choose an arbitrary coefficient, E naught. So once you have done that, to write this, you only need to be mindful of two things. This vector and the direction of propagation should be perpendicular to each other for plane waves. The B field will follow directly. First of all, the B field should be perpendicular to this, and this vector comes out to be the same, but it has to be perpendicular to this in such a manner that E, B and Z form a right-handed system. That you curl your finger from X to that direction and you get your thumb points in the direction of propagation. So the only direction left is Y, and it has a constant coefficient. And this coefficient in vacuum is equal to this. If you are confused about B field sometime, substitute this electric field in the Maxwell equation and find the magnetic field, just as we did for by substituting B field and we found electric field. So you can use the other Maxwell equation and put E in that and find B from there. Okay, so similarly, I would have taken this direction to be minus x. So then B must be minus 1. So that when I curl from my finger from minus x to minus y, thumb points in Z. Okay. Similarly, we can write, let's say, this is xy plane. So this is angle theta. And suppose the wave is propagating in this direction. How do we write the electromagnetic fields for this wave? So let's begin with the electric. And we have to choose first the direction of the field. So remember, the direction of the field and direction of propagation are two different things. The direction of field has to be perpendicular to the direction of propagation in simple mediums. So let's choose it to be, let's say, z-axis. Because z is perpendicular. You can choose this, you can choose this, you can choose any direction you want. And let's say there's some arbitrary magnitude E naught. So cosine omega t minus omega c. So this is the difficult part. What do we put here? This has to have, sorry? An echo direction, but it has to have the direction of length. And this length should be increasing in the direction of propagation. So the simplest way to find it is this. Define, first of all, just write the unit vector along the direction of propagation. What would be the unit vector along this direction? In terms of x and y. This unit vector have x hat some cosine theta plus y hat some sine theta. And then we have this position vector. Take this dot product. This dot product would be x cosine theta plus y sine. So this thing goes here. So this becomes x cosine theta minus omega over c y. You can see that this also comes from the same thing, because for this wave, this direction of propagation is z hat, and the dot product of z hat and this vector is z. So what would be the magnetic field for this? So let's make it a little quiz. Take out your pages and find the magnetic field. Write your name and hand over them. So we have about 5-6 quizzes in this course that unfortunately we couldn't find time for them before, but we will make up for them in the last one. Quiz is find B for this.